I'll go Nixonian on you. I can. I just spoke to Hugh Hewitt.
Uh-huh.
You know, the conservative talk show host.
Yeah.
And he used to work for Nixon.
Huh.
And he was really blown away by it, and by what Frank did.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what I kept getting. I was in Washington D.C. for the inauguration.
Uh-huh.
Huh. And all, you know, all the politicos and journalists who had known Nixon kept taking me aside and just saying, you know, how did Frank Langella do that? And we've never seen anyone really capture the essence
mm-hmm.
of you know, Richard Nixon. And Hugh Hewitt was saying the same thing. It was mm-hmm. really something. And then the other day I did the Morning Joe show.
Uh-huh.
And
all the conservatives.
Pat Buchanan was on the panel. He was I was in New York, mm-hmm. and he was in D.C. And he hadn't seen the film yet,
mm-hmm.
So he couldn't really comment. And he looked a little stern as he was saying, "I haven't seen it yet." And then they showed a clip mm-hmm. of Frank, and he came back and he said, "I'm stunned. It's absolutely eerie."
Mm-hmm.
Looking at Frank mm-hmm. Langella do Nixon, it was really amazing to actually really see it on his face.
Right.
It was kind of like he'd seen a ghost or something.
Well, he gets the spirit of it, I think, more than the imitation. It's not a party trick.
Frank was never trying to imitate him. In fact, I think mm-hmm. he was actively trying not to. His idea was, you know, he's a good technical actor. You know, try to do enough mm-hmm. voice and enough body language just to be mm-hmm. somewhat evocative.
Yeah.
But in no way was he reaching for an impression, which I think is really the good news. But a great lesson, great mm-hmm. in acting and directing, and because he came to understand the character on a soulful level, working mm-hmm. kind of inside out. And, you know, look how much impact he's had with the character.
Well, it felt a little to me like thinking about Joaquin Phoenix a couple years ago, I guess, with Walk the Line.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas
mm-hmm.
if you watch the movie and saw that performance, you really got Johnny Cash.
Right.
And if you listen to the soundtrack 3 weeks later,
right.
it doesn't really sound like Johnny Cash.
Yeah,
but somehow they hit the note.
You believe you're understanding something, gaining real insight into the character.
Yeah.
And, I think Peter Morgan writes that way. And I think he lives that way. I think Peter Morgan, I've been thinking a lot about this. That when you're in conversation with him, you're traveling,
mm-hmm.
and it's often very funny, but he's one of those people that can quickly discern what someone's hidden agenda is likely to be.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's usually pretty accurate about
yeah.
it, but sometimes he might be pushing it for, you know, entertainment value in one direction or the other. But I think he sees the world that way, and I think mm-hmm. that's what he saw in this story of Frost and Nixon
mm-hmm.
was an opportunity to not only sort of deal with their head-to-head clash, not only to deal with, you know, all the adventures and misadventures going on behind the scenes,
mm-hmm.
but really to expose sort of how unexpected and paradoxical the hidden agendas and the motives and were.
Kind of the theme of his work, it would seem.
I think so.
The same thing is true of The Queen, I think, on some level.
It's probably what, you know, I mean, he's a great writer.
Yeah.
But I think that's probably his superpower.
Yeah.
Is I think he discerns those things rather quickly.
So he gives actually a lot of credit to Grandage for the stage production kind of becoming more visual,
mm-hmm.
which you took to a whole nother level with the film. When did you first jump into this? When did you first see?
I read it when Karen Cahila said, you know, this is Peter Morgan's play
mm-hmm.
is being talked about as a movie. Are you interested?
Mm-hmm.
And I'd known Peter. I'd met him. We had talked about some projects here at Imagine that, one in particular that didn't come together,
mm-hmm.
but I liked him. And he had told me then, this is before The Queen came out or Last King of Scotland,
mm-hmm.
and I'd only read Peter's work. I hadn't seen anything that he'd right. done. I hadn't seen The Deal or anything.
Oh.
And he said, oh, Last King of Scotland, he explained that to me. I thought, oh, that sounds fantastic. I'd love to see that. The Queen, I said, well, that's really interesting. Boy, that's, I hadn't even thought about that relationship. Very mm-hmm. cool. And then he mentioned Frost Nixon, and he teases me that my eyes kind of glazed over, because I thought, like, look, a lot of people think, mm-hmm. okay, it's going to be a sort of a reenactment of these interviews, and they were powerful mm-hmm. at the time. They meant a lot to me at the time. But, you know, I can understand that maybe as a one act, but a whole mm-hmm. play. I certainly didn't think of it as a movie. Mm-hmm. But Karen told me that there's a lot of interest in it. And I said, well, I'd love to read it. I was kind of on vacation at the time. I was visiting my son in Hilton Head, mm-hmm. South Carolina, where he goes to school. And I read it, and I talked to Brian about it, who was either in the middle of reading it, had read it, or, mm-hmm. you know. But he was intrigued by it as well. And I told Cheryl, I said, well, I got to go back to L.A. Mm-hmm. Maybe we should just go, you know, sort of via London. And I was beginning to hear that people were bidding on it, mm-hmm. but that, you know, one way to maybe get the project would be if I would commit to making it. And I didn't have my next film. I wanted to do a movie for Universal, mm-hmm. and but I thought, well, I'm really not going to bullshit anybody. If I mm-hmm. say I'm going to do it next, I'm going to mean it. And the only way to mean it is to go see this play. And I read it, and I was very intrigued. I went to see the play, and I was completely knocked out. And I also was challenged mm-hmm. by Grandage's staging of the production. And thirdly, I'd say, I was sort of bolstered by the fact that I could say I'd make it next, because mm-hmm. I would do it with Frank Langella and Michael Sheen. Mm-hmm. I knew there'd be discussions, and, you know, and I'd want to have them. You know,
and there were rumors. I mean, there were.
Well, yeah. I mean, sure, but I was able to walk out on the sidewalk and call Brian, and then call Risa Gertner, mm-hmm. and say, you know, I not only wanted to forget developing it, I'd like to do it. I knew Peter was a great screenwriter, but right. you know, and I just felt we could get it there. As I was watching the play, I was dazzled by the staging and the inventiveness of it, mm-hmm. and the way it in very theatrical terms, it used narration, literally speaking to the audience, mm-hmm. to bridge a lot of gaps, create a kind of momentum, offer some insight into the characters, even humor, mm-hmm. you know, which I thought was really important. And that was one of the big surprises of the play, is how many laughs there really were.
Particularly from Nixon.
From Nixon. I mean, yes, you expect Frost to entertain you, but from Nixon. And but the other thing that Grandage did with his bank of television monitors is he never let you forget the fact that basically this was all about making a TV show. And I was watching it, and I knew I couldn't use a bank of monitors, but I just kept thinking, I was almost like my little Walter Mitty fantasy was like, literally just grabbing a camera and stepping up on stage and moving in, mm-hmm. because I just felt like it could be very cinematic if you made it immediate. Mm-hmm. And then I felt that you could make people understand that it was about a television show. You could even use the cameras as a kind of a boxing ring.
Right.
And I just began to find alternative, and even in my mind as I was watching it, sort of alternatives to some of the cinematic alternatives to some of the theatrical ideas that Grandage was using to such great effect.
Well, it seems like you couldn't really find a director who was more, I mean, your kid television. I mean, that's somebody who was of the era, of the moment, and so knows how television works.
Well, at the time, I remember admiring so much that David Frost had produced that program. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is before Fox, before other channels and networks and cable and et cetera. Mm-hmm. And I think he proved the premise, the business premise, that a fourth network could flourish, because he kludged together these independent stations, and that wasn't all that unusual, because things would be syndicated, you know. Mm. But he had them all play the program at the same hour. Mm-hmm. He basically turned it into a network and sold advertising as though it was a network, and made it work. And so, you know, not only was it significant historically, Not only did it grab the world's attention, the media's attention at that time, mm-hmm. but it was really, you know, a bravura act of entrepreneurship.
Yeah, but the other thing with you is that you understand the power of that camera. And well, it's a television camera. Not, I mean, the film manages to give us both.
Yeah, well, you know, look, there's so, the thing I like about the story, and it was made it so much so interesting to work with directorially, it was is that it's not about it's not a single theme. Mm-hmm. It's really you know, there are different people discover for themselves the most important ideas. Mm-hmm. There are a number of ideas, and what I appreciated that about it and tried to identify them. Mm-hmm. and make them all work and make them all just significant enough. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, if you, the audience member, decided that was the most important one, you know, you weren't cheated. Mm-hmm. That, you know, those ideas were developed.
Yeah.
But there were just a number of them on a human level, historic, political, you know, on a sociological level. Mm-hmm. Television and so forth. It's one of the things that gives the story or viewers a kind of an energized experience.
Well, you also picked actors who were, I mean, your supporting cast. Frank is kind of the big story out of this whole thing.
Yeah.
Constantly talking about it, but the cast is pretty stunning.
Well, they really are. Michael Sheen is fantastic, and I'm really sorry that in this award season he didn't get more notice.
Yeah. It's a weird phenomenon of that, you know, whole supporting, not supporting. It's,
should he have gone for that? Yeah. He didn't feel that was correct, given that it was, you know, he's a title character, and I'm, and I'm not. And look, given what the Academy did with Kate Winslet in The Reader, they might not have accepted that in any way had Universal tried to sell that idea to voters.
Yeah.
But
of course, he got caught in the same thing with The Queen.
But you know, people are going to quickly realize that here's this guy giving all these fantastic performances. Let's notice him, and that's going to happen for him, soon. I'm sorry, it didn't happen on this.
Not in Underworld 3, I don't think.
Maybe not, but
then we talked to him last year, right after he finished shooting this, and as he was starting Underworld 3, and that bush of his, it was a little scary.
He had one loop line that he had to do while he was doing Underworld.
Uh-huh.
I needed him to do a new line, and I said, "You're filming every day?" He said, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, could you get your boom guy to just do a wild line, you know, back in your trailer or something?" He said, "Sure." And I said, "If you happen to be in your werewolf makeup when you do it, will you please take a picture?" And he did. And so there's this perfect recording of him announcing Ivan Goolagong. Mm-hmm. And this photograph I have of him, you know, with the frost kind of look. I think he's got, like, I don't know, a spike through his neck and his hair and blood. It's fantastic.
Hey, that's funny. But so the rest of the supporting cast?
Well, look, it's about something. It's about a lot of things. This story. They all, you know, actors wanted to be a part of it. It's great writing.
Kevin's role kind of got beefed up. Kevin Bacon.
All the roles got beefed up.
Yeah.
Partly because I felt like one of the ways to open the film up was to delve into the supporting characters a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Not in terms of giving them subplots or whole new story scenes or anything, but to just keep letting that camera move. Let's keep touching base with the various characters. And then the mm-hmm. thing that I said to Peter, and you know, gratefully he went along with this and was supportive of it, was that I said, there's this great writing between Frost and Nixon and all mm-hmm. these other scenes that are fantastic from the play, and of course we want it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to encourage these guys to improvise in and around this a lot. I would love it if we could achieve a kind of an Altman-esque mm-hmm. Quality of spontaneity.
Mm-hmm.
And visually, that was the way I was going to shoot it. Not faux documentary, but just a very unrehearsed, spontaneous, naturalistic visual style.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I was trying to move away from anything that would feel too formal or presentational or mm-hmm. too organized, and give something very immediate and sort of experiential for mm-hmm. film audiences. And I thought it would help create more suspense too, and tension. And these actors really took to it. Not that you know, look, there's some great improvised lines. Some of them get laughs. Some of them, you know, are intensify the drama. But there's not that much that's really new dialogue. But it made every moment just so alive.
Well, Rockwell and Platt are kind of goofy, great.
They're great. Yeah. Oh, they're great, and they, you know, and they came up with some great stuff. You know, deep crack lines, and I don't know. At one point, Sam Rockwell, you know, calls David Frost Little Lord Fauntleroy, and you know, there were lots of, you know, you can't call that a theme, but when you started interviewing these guys, you realize that there is this undercurrent of cultural tension between the Brits and the and the Americans, even on the Frost team, right. And they were all pulling in the same direction, no question, but. You know, so it was, when they remember it, they remember it sort of almost with nostalgia, almost fondly, with humor. But at the time, long hours, late night, they didn't entirely trust each other, and they didn't know what the agendas exactly were, and we wanted to utilize that.
Well, the subtext is so much more profound for the Americans in that situation than for the Brits. Mm-hmm. You know, they're trying to put on a TV show, and these guys want to really bring down the ex-president.
This is really important for us. But again, it was just fun, fascinating filmmaking because it was so important to keep the story tight, and we didn't have a lot of time to, you know, sort of shoot things various ways and try to go discover it in the editing room. I mean, I shot a lot of film, but it was always, you know, my purpose had to be pretty clear with every setup and every scene. And but you know it was just fun and interesting to just try to keep all the values alive, so that, you know, every scene was working on a few different levels.
You've now been a director pretty much longer than you were an actor, really.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, the first movie I directed was in 77, Grand Theft Auto, and then I'd started acting in 58, and then I pretty much left acting in 81 or 82. Yeah. So, you know, yeah, I think what Matt probably tips toward the directing now.
So do you think of acting with nostalgia now, or is it?
I wouldn't mind doing a little bit of acting again, now that the kids are grown. Cheryl always asked me to, you know, if it wasn't my primary career, always involved in Imagine, you know. Right. So, you know, if I wasn't directing, you know, I could be helpful in the company, and so she said, you know, don't dabble in acting. If you know, dabble in us, our family. How about that? And I thought that was a pretty fair request.
Yeah.
That if I had time devoted to that, but now everybody's grown, and over the years, you know, occasionally some really interesting filmmakers have you know, invited me to do things that I just couldn't take them up on it, and I don't regret it because, you know, I love sticking with my family. But it would be interesting to actually see how these other filmmakers who I admire so much function, you know. And so beyond the what might be personally interesting, just to try to see what it's like in front of a camera again, it would also be just great to be on a set and see what they do.
Of course, I guess you get to go in and do voiceovers, or did for a few years. And
that was great. I love doing the voiceovers. I wouldn't call that, you know, there's no heavy lifting there from an acting standpoint, but they did begin to give me a little bit of an arc, and I loved doing that, and I'm really hoping I get to reach for the microphone one more time for the movie version.
It was quite the buzz at Sundance this year.
Was it?
Michael Cera was up there, and he was, you know, maybe it's happening, maybe it's not happening. People were like going nuts about it.
Mitch Hurwitz is getting ready to write, or may be writing, and the studio is very, very enthusiastic. The cast is enthusiastic, or ranging from, you know, very eager to read it,
right,
to I don't need to read it, I'll be there, but people are. Mitch is going to write something that everybody's going to want to be involved in. That's my hunch.
So when you have a love affair show like that, which obviously didn't get the ratings it wanted, but had everything else, is that the same kind of feeling as having a movie work as a producer or as a director? Or is it?
Well, it's been kind of interesting that because in a way, you know, it became more popular when it was canceled. I mean, people mm-hmm. liked it, but it was out there, it was being advertised. When they could discover it mm-hmm. or champion it, I don't know what the numbers are. I don't, you know, right. I mean, well, we were probably getting 1.5 million or 2 million people watching it, right. you know, when it was on the air. Uh-huh. You know, I'm sure, I don't know how many people watch it now per week. If you, mm-hmm. but somebody's bumping into me literally every day saying, I just watched the DVDs again, or I just mm-hmm. bought the DVDs, or now I'm downloading them, or, right. you know. And so it's been really fun to have this cherished show, yeah. Especially with the possibility of doing the movie, because it's, you know, it's not just water under the bridge.
So do you feel a generational jump like that with some of your early pictures now? I mean, it's interesting that it's almost like Cocoon and Splash are now in last generation movies
that are now ready to come back again. Well, I don't know about that. I don't hear about those movies as much as I used to.
Right.
In fact, when I check online mm-hmm. and people sort of check, you know, rate them, Ron Howard Films or something right. like that, you know, Willow rates really, really high. But the critics were so hard on Willow when yeah. it came out, and did okay box office. You know, it wasn't like Star Wars, but it was, I think, in the top, not the top 10, but maybe the top 15 its mm-hmm. year. It did sort of fine, mm-hmm. but the critics were pretty rough on it. And now it's this really, you know, so well regarded.
Yeah.
It reminds me of this story that I have. I'd gotten to know Billy Wilder just a little bit. I took him out with Lowell Ganz and Babalu Mandel, who just loved Billy Wilder, and mm-hmm. of course wrote, you know, Splash and Night Shift and Parenthood and Gung Ho, and we're very good friends. We took Billy Wilder out to lunch at one point, and he was very gracious and all that. And then I bumped into him after he saw Apollo 13, and he said, "You know what I liked about that movie?" He said, "It was a movie about people who didn't get to the moon. It was a movie about people who didn't get their dream,
mm-hmm.
And all the emotions that go with that." And I really liked that. I thought it was such an interesting perspective. I always felt that,
right.
but it was interesting that for him, that was the sort of the singular idea. But at the same time, I said, you know, I directed Glenn Close, so I saw Sunset Boulevard on stage. That made me want to go back and see the movie. You know, what a film. What a remarkable movie that completely holds up.
Yeah.
And he said, I can't do his accent. He said, suddenly everyone likes that one. He said when it came out, you know, it mm-hmm. sort of played in L.A. and New York and went away. And so, you know, I took that as a sort of a life lesson.
Yeah.
I think you love the idea enough to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You love it as much as you can as you make it.
Mm-hmm.
You love it and hate it when it's done, because by then there's some things that must bug you.
Mm-hmm.
You put it out there. It is what it is at that moment. And then it's sort of interesting to see what sort of life it does or doesn't, you know, take on after that. It's fascinating.
Well, it's weird to look back at Kubrick and realize how pretty much every movie except for Strangelove got beat up when it came out, and they've all become, you know, ultimate cult classics.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
people, you know.
I didn't really know that the critics had been tough
Strangelove
on.
Was the only one that actually did well with the critics.
Really?
And, yeah. In 2001, he actually pulled from release. And recut,
no
and put back out again. Yeah,
I didn't. Wow,
it was craziness. But the Coen brothers, same kind of thing. They don't, you know, every one of their pictures, very rare that they get accolades early.
Mm-hmm.
And then people were, you know, the Big Lebowski is still, you know, was a great cult film
yeah.
for the last decade.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a crazy thing.
Yeah.
But do you feel like you? I mean, it's an interesting phenomenon with you. Had all the success, remarkable career mm-hmm. as a director, certainly, Academy Awards, all the mm-hmm. attention, and yet. Critics do seem to beat the hell out of you.
Well, sometimes they do, and sometimes they don't. You know, I mean, it's really interesting. I mean, they certainly went right after, you know, Da Vinci Code.
Yeah.
But our Rotten Tomato scores is pretty wonderful for Frost Nixon.
Right.
So, you know, it's that. And before Da Vinci Code was Cinderella Man, which you know was very well reviewed. So I think when they go after me, they really let me have it.
Yeah.
Maybe that's fair. I don't know.
There seems to be a restraint. I mean, I of course went through the whole thing with Missing, where mm-hmm. I feel like you got, you know, very unfairly kicked for theoretically, you know, stealing from John Ford, which all the critics seem to be obsessed with.
And, yeah.
And somehow stolen the Searchers, and I'm like, he made a movie. You
know. Well, thank you. No, I was a little surprised by that, and I have been, frustrated about it. I think just about everybody goes through that at some point or another. But it's not to make it easy for you guys, but I think it's kind of a tough job, and you have to try to, you know, take strong opinions and in order to be. You know, otherwise, why are you there? In a way.
I think we carry a certain chip on our shoulder about certain people in certain ways.
Well, if there's anything that might be, I don't know, where I might feel like I'm slightly misunderstood or something, it's that I like a lot of different kinds of movies. As a filmmaker, I do. And I like populist, escapist entertainment. Mm-hmm. When they're well done, I love them. And I've made some that I'm really proud of and that I really enjoy. Mm-hmm. Those are really a high wire act. If they miss a little, mm-hmm. they miss a lot. But I enjoy tackling those mm-hmm. and trying. And they can be incredibly lucrative, and when they work, you know. And when they don't, they're disappointed. But the it's very, very important to me to not feel cornered creatively ever. Mm-hmm. And I'd say if there's any one thing I would battle, it would be some sort of stereotyping of me as a director that would limit me. Mm-hmm. I don't care what anybody writes, as long as it doesn't start limiting me in terms of what I can get talented people to agree to work with me on,
right.
or studios or financiers to support me in. Mm-hmm. And as long as I can make the stuff that I care about, then, you know, I feel I'm very philosophical. Mm-hmm. If I sense that there's some sort of movement or tendency to want to push me into some corner or create a label for me that's going to be limiting in some way, then that's the only thing that will get me in the gut, because mm-hmm. because it's just crucial that in my mind that I not feel that if I make this movie they won't accept it.
Right.
You know, they, whoever they is.
Sorry, is there a movie you haven't been able to make?
No, I don't think so. No. I'm trying to think of something. I mean, there have been some movies I really liked that I couldn't make.
Right.
That I balked on and other filmmakers made. Mm-hmm. But anything that I've developed that I loved enough to fight for, I've been able to get made.
Well, it would seem your commercial success would be, you know, if there's anything consistent, it's that you make money for the people who you work with. I mean, it's not been.
Yeah, I mean, it's. We're outside of like, look, you know, you're doing The Grinch Who Stole Christmas with Jim mm-hmm. Carrey. Pretty good chance that's going to make some money. You're making The Da Vinci Code, and it's. Of course, when we got involved in it, it wasn't right at the center of this cult of the zeitgeist. It was a beginning to be a bestseller, and mm-hmm. it was beginning to be talked about. But we suddenly looked around as we were developing it and realized, man, this is look at these documentaries people are making about mm-hmm. it, and that none of that had happened when I first got involved. So it kind of turned into that. Mm-hmm. But you sort of felt like that, you know, that's a title that Sony's going to really be able to market, right. and they should be able to open it. Opening it doesn't mean it should do $750 million worldwide,
right?
And so you know, which is probably why they were, you know, and we all so eager to go ahead and get involved in Angels and Demons, because clearly there's an audience for Robert Langdon and the Dan Brown Robert Langdon adventures. But a lot of things, like Brian has a much better sense, a better nose for what mm-hmm. can be commercial. He really does. You know, he thought Apollo 13 was a good bet. I thought it was a potentially great movie, and I mm-hmm. kept thinking, God, the only thing we can compare this to is The Right Stuff, which I thought was fantastic and was a big box office disappointment. You know, I certainly didn't think Beautiful Mind was going to be commercial.
Was so commercial. It was like a big number.
I mean, you know, I didn't. I was shocked that they were letting me do Cocoon. I was hired for Cocoon, mm-hmm. but you know, it's about senior citizens, and you know, and it's there's some science fiction elements, but mm-hmm. you know, I was you know, really surprised that it did as well as it did. So those are probably the ones that wound up being really commercial that surprised me.
So when you go back to Angels, do you carry that Rotten Tomato score on your shoulder and worry about it, or think about it, or develop away from it, or
could not develop away from it? There's nothing you could do, because I did everything I thought I ought to do for Da Vinci mm-hmm. Code, and gave it, you know, and I don't look back at it, and see particular missteps. Mm-hmm. It was a very difficult adaptation. Mm-hmm. But I really enjoyed making the movie, and I loved dealing with the themes that we got to deal with, and we did the best we could. Angels and Demons is like a whole other movie. It's Robert Langdon, and there's an element of the sort of phrase here, religious thriller or something, you know, I don't know, but it's really Robert Langdon is really the only thing it shares,
right.
The two films share it. It's tonally, it's just so different. Mm-hmm. It's probably a closer cousin to Ransom or something than anything mm-hmm. else that I've done in terms of just contemporary
right.
thriller. It's much bigger than Ransom, and it's much more of a you know, just a full-on mm-hmm. Entertainment, and yet, what I like about Dan Brown is he puts Langdon in these situations that that are thought-provoking in certain
right.
ways, and do stimulate some conversation,
mm-hmm.
I have no idea what the Rotten Tomato score will be, but. And you know, I feel like there was a big readership of the novel,
yeah.
and I think people are going to be interested in the story.
So, what's the measure of success for Frost Nixon? You're not getting to the you've got your nominations and all of that. Is it?
I'm feeling really gratified by the way the movie's been received, the way audiences respond to it,
mm.
the award recognition been great. You know. I'm rooting for Frank Langella. I think it's a tremendous performance. It's a year where there are some great performances out there.
Yeah.
But and so without being anything but laudatory of everyone else's work,
right.
I do have to say that you know, I think if Frank came away with an Academy Award, that it would be just. I really think that it's a very particular challenge and a kind of a dangerous role for an actor to undertake, and he just pulled it off
mm-hmm.
with such artistry that I'm rooting for him to be recognized, and I think the film was made modestly. I think by the time it runs through.
Mm-hmm.
All the markets and drifts into its afterlife. That, you know, mm-hmm. the studio's going to be fine. And so, it's been a really rare and wonderful experience.
Well, you wear all the different hats. Do you think of it? I mean, can you separate your mindset about it as a director from being a producer, from being a career, from
No,
just kind of blend into
it's all filmmaking to me, you know, and that's
yeah.
the way I view everything. And when I'm not going to direct it,
mm-hmm.
you know, I can help Brian and be a little more of a pragmatist or a mm-hmm. or more producerial, even though he's really the driving producerial force behind mm-hmm. behind all the movies. But I can. When asked, and you know, I throw in my two cents and read and get involved and so forth. But once I'm making the movie and I'm living it,
mm-hmm.
You know, I think about all the aspects. But I'm not much of a careerist.
Mm-hmm.
I just ultimately it's really boils down to this litmus test:
mm-hmm.
Can I stand to not make this movie? Is my stomach going to churn every time Every time I see this title, mm-hmm. and somebody else made it, you know, and when I reach that point with the movie, I just know that on some level, I've got to do it. Should do it.
Do you feel peace though when you come finish with post, or is it when you've seen how the audience responds?
How the audience responds is the main thing. How I feel about it.
Right.
Well, you know, I've been through some test screenings by the time we get through post.
Right.
So I have an idea what audiences think anyway.
Right.
But ultimately that's really it. Mm-hmm. Second would probably be what peers seem to think of it. Mm-hmm. So it's and I do care about what critics think, particularly in mass. You know, mm-hmm. I think it's interesting to know, and I think I have learned things. I don't read the reviews carefully,
right.
but especially as time lapses, I go back, mm-hmm. I review, and I get a sense of their thoughts, and it's, you know, can be meaningful sometimes, and the box office I think is kind of a fluke.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think that it's great when it happens. It's lucrative. It's exciting. It becomes a thing that builds on itself. So generally, when people sense that it's, you know, a lot of people are going, that means mm-hmm. more people rush to go.
Right.
More than with reviewers, you know, yeah. box office seems to fuel more people going.
Yeah.
News about box office mm-hmm. seems to push people to the theater, you know, more than great reviews.
Right. And you kind of let Brian whip the horse at Universal to get them to do the marketing the way that you guys want.
He's great at that.
His thing. Yeah.
Yeah, he's great at that. And I, you know, again, I participate but I trust his judgment so much more than my own
mm-hmm.
when it comes to that. He's a really good producer. He's really, really good. He's very smart. He's got a great story mind. You know, today we were sitting and we were looking at a recent cut of Angels and Demons, and we hadn't actually sat side by side during a screening yet, mm-hmm. Which we always do at, you know, a couple times at some point. And we were just going back and forth, and he was asking some questions, and they're always, you know, he's incredibly supportive, but, you know, really good, strong, thoughtful
mm-hmm.
questions, very detail-oriented, more than he lets on, more than, you know, he's got a good, really good film mind.
It's the hair, throws everybody off.
It's his demeanor, you know, he doesn't necessarily trust himself creatively, in all honesty.
Mm-hmm.
He trusts his gut,
mm-hmm.
but... And he wants to speak out, but you know, he really wants his ideas to even be filtered to a large degree, unless he's certain he's right. You
right.
know, once in a while he lands on a point that
yeah.
he, you know, really trusts. And of course, I'm always encouraging him to trust that gut even more. And I think I've always felt that one of the real advantages that I've had in being partnered with him is not only the mutual support, not only the value of you know, the intelligence mm-hmm. and taste of the Imagine executives, who are fantastic, led by Karen Kehila, mm-hmm. you know, but the fact that I really can get Brian's attention and say, really, what do you think? I really want to know.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, directors who aren't partnered with them are, you know, they're not going to prod them in that
right.
way. I just as I wouldn't probably prod other producers who I mm-hmm. have a lot of respect for, but I don't have that friendship with.
Yeah. So was there a moment in Frost Nixon at this point where you went, okay, I've done it, it's good?
We had a really, really good screening in Nyack, New Jersey, and it was early, still early in the cut. It wasn't a final cut.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just a digital output off the Avid.
Mm-hmm.
And Brian was there, Peter Morgan was there, and it just played great in New Jersey, and I realized it could be an audience movie,
mm-hmm.
and that doesn't necessarily mean, you know, turnstiles, you
right.
know, and tickets flying out the window,
mm-hmm.
but it means that I realized that it wasn't it wasn't so rarefied. Mm-hmm. You didn't have to be fascinated by the subject to enjoy the movie. You didn't have to have lived through it to be feel suspense mm-hmm. or and really be drawn in to the story. And that was a great screening. Mm-hmm. I really made me happy, and I haven't had a bad screening with the film since.